Is anybody running their phones in the sanctuary?
Your presence fill this place, oh, right where we are. Come and let your presence fill our praise, fill our praise. Come and let your presence fill this place.
Hallelujah. Yes, hallelujah. Come on, welcome him into this place. Hallelujah. We exalt you, Lord.
Praise your name, Jesus.
Oh, yes,
glory,
Lord.
Hallelujah. Glory, glory.
We love you. We love you.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore every heart that is broken.
Yes,
and great are you, Lord.
Say it again, you give life,
you give life. You are love.
Yes,
you bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is broken. And great are you, Lord.
It's your breath
in our lungs. So we sing your praise. You are worthy of our praise. You give life. You are love. You bring light to the darkness. You give hope. You restore every heart that is so we pour out our praise, you are.
fear. Shaking off fear.
Exalted in this place, Lord. Yes. Be exalted in Jesus' name.
'Tis so sweet to trust in Jesus, just to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise, just to know the says the Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how he's proved him o'er and o'er. Jesus, Jesus, precious Jesus, all for grace to trust. I trust my Jesus. I trust my Jesus.
Oh, we love you, Lord God.
Leaning independent.
You're so awesome, Lord. We love you. Give him all that you've got this morning.
Yes, God, yes, God.
Just pour your heart out. Pour your heart out and let him know it loves him and worships him alone.
To see things like you do, God, I look to you.
just what to do.
Hallelujah, here we go,
Hallelujah, our God.
I will love you, Lord. Hallelujah. 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 I will love you, Lord.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, yes, yes. Oh,
yes,
yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes,
I
Lord.
I love you, Lord.
Hallelujah. Yeah, yeah. You know, I just have the giggles this morning because I sense the presence of Daddy God. Hallelujah. He is Abba Father, and that means that He's our daddy. He desires for us to feel joy, to feel peace. He is Abba Father. Lord God, I thank you. I thank you. I can rest and have peace of mind because you are my dad, and I thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are Elohim, Lord God. You have everything under control. Hallelujah. You are Creator God, and we thank you. We thank you, Lord God. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you, Father.
Yeah.
Thank you, Father. Blessed
we
be.
We love you, Lord. We love you.
Blessed be. Blessed be.
Mm-hmm. We love you so much, Lord. Have your way in this place, Lord God.
Yeah, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah.
Pastor.
Hallelujah. Welcome, everyone, to our Bethel service this morning. For those of you who are viewing streaming, you probably recognize, heard some clapping and people in the background. We do have a small audience this morning, and we've invited some of our leaders and essential people to prepare for next week, because next week we will be having a full-blown service. We're inviting everybody to come. If you're uncomfortable, we just want to let you know that we do have special spacing on our seatings. And we are taking measures to protect everyone. If you're still not comfortable, we will be streaming next week as well. So we just want to make the gathering here available to everyone who wants to be a part of it, and continue to do the streaming as well. I know that we have a few people who have been watching on our streaming service that have not been regular attenders of Bethel, and we welcome you. We praise God that we hope you continue to watch our streaming service. We're excited about what Jesus Christ is doing. Our desire is to connect people to God, and as we connect people to God, we believe connecting people to people is also very important. So we invite you to come and be a part of our service every Sunday, 10 a.m. We have small groups. We call connect groups, and we're excited about those that cause us to, or allow us to be able to connect with each other and form relationships. The body of Christ is all about relationship. We're a community. We're supposed to be a community. And I'll talk a little bit about that this morning in my message, but we are to gather as a community and share burdens with one another, share joys with one another, share difficulties that we go through with one another as an encouragement, an opportunity to encourage and lift up one another in Jesus' name. Well, I also want to thank everyone who has been giving on a regular basis. We're just so thankful that everyone continues to give. Next week, we will have our offering in the back of the church, so that you can come prepared. Just drop it in. You can drop it in before or after the service. We're going to do our best to keep the social distancing, so we're not going to have our ushers walking around taking up offerings, but we're going to make it available for you to give. As we prepare this morning, our hearts for worship, I would like to pray over all those who have been giving faithfully. I always like to proclaim a blessing out of Deuteronomy, because God has promised that He will bless those who faithfully give and support the ministry of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Father God, we thank you and we praise you this morning that you are touching your people, and that you have so many faithful people that regardless of whether we are able to come together, they continue to support the ministry that is so important to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Lord, that you bless us when we come in. You bless us when we go out. You bless us in the cities. You bless us in the country. You bless us in our kneading bowls and our baskets. Father God, you bless us at whatever we put our hands to. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God.
As Pastor Rob said, we just want to welcome everybody to our online service, plus those of you who have joined us this morning here in-house. And I was standing in the back, and it was just, I could feel your excitement as you were worshiping this morning because you've come back together. And, you know, I don't think that until this happened, we realized how special it was and what a privilege it was to come together as the body of Christ. And although we're practicing the social distancing and just doing kind of like a virtual high five and hug, I just, you know, we will get through this. You know, Abba Father, like Ivy was saying, he's taken good care of us, and this too shall pass. So just hang on. Rob covered some of this stuff, but this is a letter that was mailed out earlier this week, or late last week, actually, to our Bethel family. It was also posted on our page. But I just want to read this to all of you to let you know what it'll look like when you come next week. We're excited to announce we'll be resuming our in-house worship services on Pentecost Sunday, May 31st, 2020 at 10 a.m. It will be great to see our church family as we come together under one roof. Of course, we understand some folks will choose to stay home and watch our service live stream, and that is perfectly understandable. To assure you and prepare you for coming back to Bethel, the elders and core leadership have implemented the following safety measures. Number one, the cafe, nursery, and Kids Zone Ministry will not be operating at this time. Feel free to bring your own coffee or water to the service. Miss Dot will have activity bags for the children to use and take home during the service. And we do have some tables with chairs set up towards the back of the sanctuary that families can sit at so their kids can have a table. And, you know, we still want them to engage in the service, but we understand little ones get fidgety, so we want to just prepare some stuff for them, activities that tie into the message. So Miss Dot, our children's pastor, will have some stuff ready for the children. The doors will be opened by our greeters and ushers, so that will just be, you know, so one less thing that you'll have to worry about, you know, touching. The sanctuary has been set up for seating with the recommended social distancing. Families are asked to sit together, which means families, you know, keep your kids with you. We have an offering container set up right inside the sanctuary doors for you to give your tithes and offerings. You can still give online as before, but we do have a container in the back. If you or your child needs to use the restroom during the service, we ask you quietly to exit and re-enter the sanctuary. And we have an usher back there. He will open the door, close it for you. And we do have some signs posted in the restroom with a limit of two people in a restroom at a time, the public restroom. So please keep in mind to practice the recommended social distancing while you arrive and leave the service. We realize some of you will have to exercise great strength when coming in because you want to shake a hand or give a loved one a hug. But for right now, we ask for you to refrain from any social or physical contact while at Bethel. If you have any questions or concern, please give Pastor Rob or me a call and we'll address the issue. Thank you. I don't have any other announcements, but I do have a very special friend here with us this morning. I asked Kelly, how long have you been attending Bethel? And I was thinking maybe like 3 years. She said it's been about 5 years. She lived up around the Belpre area and was moving down this way. And while she was building, she started attending and got plugged in. She is part of my life group, my Connect group. Just love her to pieces. She's got a lot of wisdom. She's a retired Christian school teacher. But normally she would be singing on the praise team. She will be back, but she just has an incredible testimony that I asked her to share about God's divine healing in her body. Kelly, come on up. Let's give it up for Kelly.
Well, praise the Lord, church. Pastor Otis and Sister Ivy, it is so good to see you, and you're not in a
good
screen.
To see you.
It's so nice. As some of you know, on April the 2nd, I had a surgery, and they was doing surgery on my spine. And when I got up there to do the surgery, the doctor came to me about 5 minutes before surgery was to take place, and he was talking to me, and I told him, I said, I've been praying for you. And he said, that is wonderful, because before every surgery, us surgeons get together and we pray, which I thought that was great. And so he started talking about church, and he wanted to know what I did in church. So I told him that I sang on the praise team, and he got very quiet. And I said, Doc, why are you so quiet? What happened? And he said, you may never sing on the praise team again. And I said, that's not going to happen. And he went back to do the surgery. And as I sat there, I thought, you know, my son couldn't come in. He was out in the car. And so I thought, I just need to go out and get in the car and go home. That was my feeling. Because my voice isn't that great, but what I got, I'm not losing. And so I laid there a little bit, and there were so many people that was coming in during this period, no one came in. And it's because God wanted me to shut up a minute so he could talk to me. And finally, it dawned on me. Kelly, God did not bring you this far to take your voice, what you use to worship and to praise him with, he's not going to take away from you. So I went ahead and did the surgery. And after the surgery was over with, the first day I really didn't talk much. But after that, I started talking. I was staying with my son and daughter-in-law, and I started talking a lot to them. And within 2 days, my voice is the same as what you hear right now. And so, God is good. And so, I decided that every couple of days, I would hum very lowly. And then in a couple of days, I would raise it up, and then raise it up. And then I sang a line. And we'd just sing one line, and then stop, not do no more, because I didn't want to hurt anything. And then I would slowly raise the tone up and raise it up.
Come on now.
And I did this for 3.5 weeks until I was to go back to see the doctor. And when I walked in there, the doctor said, good morning. And I said, well, hi, Doc, how you doing? And he just like stopped in his tracks and turned and looked at me. He said, you should not be speaking.
Come on now.
And of course, I didn't know anybody that had this exact surgery. I mean, I'd read a lot about it, and you know, and it didn't look too nice the way they opened stuff up and all that. But he said, I just came from the room of a man that had the surgery the day after you had your surgery. He said, the exact same surgery. He said, that man, I can barely understand what he's saying to me. He said, but that's normal. He said, and you're talking like you did before we ever had surgery. I said, Doc, that's nothing. I can sing too.
Come on.
And he had a folder in his hand. He took the folder and he hit me on the arm and he said, no way. He said, there is no way that you can sing. I said, I can do everything but my highest note. I said, I can't quite hit it yet without something hurting. I said, but you give me a couple weeks and I'll hit that too. It'll be okay.
Come on, that's right.
And he said, you should not be talking completely for a year. So until next April, I'm not supposed to be able to talk the way I am. He said, let alone sing. He said, singing would come after that. He said, I have had professional singers come in here and they can't get their voice back. He said, and yours was back in 3 weeks. I said, Doc, but God.
Yeah. Come on.
Oh, hallelujah.
But God. God is so good, and I just want to thank him and praise him this morning, not just for my voice, but for getting me through the entire thing and just being there with me when I went in, you know, it's strange to go in a hospital and have surgery by yourself. I'd never done that before. My son had always been right beside me saying, Mom, just be quiet. Everything's going to be okay. You know, that's my son. But God was so good. He was there the whole time, even in my doubt, even in my not being sure of what was going to happen. God said, I got this. So just remember, when things don't go the way you think they should go, God's got this. Yes.
Come on now, that's awesome. Yes.
Hey, man, what an awesome testimony. Just appreciate Kelly so much and her faith. And God is just well able to do incredible things. I believe God is still doing incredible miracles today. All we have to do is just trust in Him. He's on the throne. He's keeping us and He's protecting us. And yes, we're going through a difficult time with COVID-19, but God, you know, that didn't catch God off guard. He knew, he understands, and He is still with us. I believe He's protecting us and keeping us. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. All right, well, this morning I want to talk about I will build my church. I want to talk about the fact that Jesus, or there's certain things about the church, and Jesus said that He would build His church. I read a little thing this week about a churchgoer who wrote a letter into an editor to a newspaper, and he complained about church. He said that, I've been going to church for 30 years now, and in that time I've heard about 3,000 sermons. But for the life of me, I can't remember any of the content of those sermons. I'm beginning to think it's just a waste of time, and those ministers are wasting their time preaching. Well, that started a real controversy. Everybody started sending letters into the editor, and the editor loved it because it's selling papers and people were reading the paper, and there was a lot of controversy going on until finally one guy wrote a letter into the editor, and he said, I have been married for 30 years now. In that time, my wife has cooked over 32,000 meals. But for the life of me, I cannot recall one full menu that she has prepared for me. However, I do know this, that those meals nourished me. And without those meals, I would be physically dead today. Likewise, if I was not going to church and hearing those sermons, I would be spiritually dead today. That's the importance of congregating, coming to church, hearing the Word of God. Sometimes we don't remember all the content, but it really does impact us. That's why it's so important that we share the Word of God with our children. You know, that we tell them the great Bible lessons and teach them the great Bible lessons, and we share the Word of God with them, because they may not remember all the content, but they will remember the power of God in their life. Matthew chapter 6, verse 18 says, and I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not prevail. One thing we have to understand is the church is not just a venue. Yes, we have a place where we gather as the church. But the church is a value. We are important. We're important to one another. We're important to our community. We're important to families. We're important to our nation. The nation doesn't realize just how important the church is. One day they will. But the church is extremely important. The church is not an organization as much as it is an organism that was planted by Jesus Christ to grow the kingdom of God. Church, we are. It's not this building. We are the church. And Jesus Christ has established the church, and He said, I will build my church. So first of all, the first principle that I want to look at this morning is that Jesus said, I will build my church. The word here, well, let's go back to that scripture in Matthew 16, 18. And I also say to you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overpower it. Here's the thing that we need to recognize, that Jesus uses two Greek words here. First of all, Peter means Petros, or little rock or little stone. And the next line he says, on this rock, and that he uses the word Petra there, which is a rock or a large stone. So Jesus, although he was talking to Peter, he wasn't telling Peter that he was the rock that was going to be, the church was going to be built on. He was talking about himself. On this rock, myself, I'm going to build the church. The church is built on the solid rock, the foundation of the Lord Jesus Christ. The church expands because of the Lord Jesus Christ, because of the blood of the Lamb of Jesus Christ. People are called into the kingdom to do the work of the ministry, but nothing will happen unless Holy Spirit moves among the people and the power of God is released. The Greek word here that is translated church is a gathering. It means, it's ekklesia, and it means a gathering of citizens called out from their homes into a public place or assembly. During when the Romans conquered the Greeks, they adopted this ekklesia that the Greeks had established. It was a way of governing the local establishments or local settlements and local cities and towns. It was really a local device that allowed the people to come out and discuss important matters and come to a conclusion with their officials of how they should handle each and every law and situation in their cities. According to the Greek lexicon, it says that the word ekklesia is found in 115 places in the New Testament. And it's translated in those places, church or assembly. So we're talking about an assembly of people. What I want you to understand is that Jesus didn't coin this word, this is my church. No, he was building on something that the society was very familiar with during his time. He was building on the ecclesia of the Roman government. But he was saying, my ecclesia will be different than the ecclesia of the world. My ecclesia will do things in a different way. This is what I'm going to build. It's going to be something much different than you're used to. Jesus established the ecclesia, the church, and he grows the church. When Rome conquered the Greek Empire, they continued this practice, but they did something a little different. The Romans decided that they were going to use this vehicle, the ecclesia, to expand their empire. They took nobles and they trained them in the Roman imperial ways, and they allowed them to recruit normal people in the community, soldiers, farmers, craftsmen, people of all walks of life, people who were looking for something more out of life than just normal day-to-day life. People, adventurous people, it seemed like. Because what they were going to do was they were going to go to the outskirts of the Roman Empire, and they were going to establish a settlement. And those settlements were going to become a place to expand the Roman Empire. Jesus Christ has called those same kind of people, just normal, everyday people, but people who are looking for more than just a normal life. People who are looking for fulfillment in a spiritual relationship with the Lord, and a renewed relationship with God himself. We are the ecclesia of Jesus Christ. We are different than the world. We are supposed to be the called out ones. We are supposed to be planting and expanding the kingdom of God one soul at a time. We are to be calling people not into a physical kingdom. The physical kingdom hasn't come yet. Into a spiritual kingdom. And Jesus said, I will build my church. I will build my church. That sets me free. I want you all to understand that. Because I've gotten in the past, I've gotten to the place where I felt like, wow, we got to do this and we got to do that and we've got to have certain things in order and we've got to create a certain atmosphere. That's a bunch of nonsense. Yes, sir. What we have to do is follow the leading of Holy Spirit. And if we follow the leading of Holy Spirit, He will build the church. All we have to do is come alongside Him as His partners and accomplish the things that He has a desire for. We are born again. We have joined the ecclesia of Jesus Christ, and it's an exciting place to be, especially in these last days. There is no more exciting place than to serve Jesus Christ with all your heart, soul, and mind. But we have to get back to the place where we're doing that, where we're putting aside, you know, this time of social distancing and, staying at home, not being able to get out and do things. It has, I think, made us appreciate exactly how important it is to be able to come together and worship the Lord. But it's also, I hope that it's caused us to recognize that some of the things that we thought were so important are not as important as we thought they were. The real important things, family, our church, our relationship with God above all else, that's the most important thing. Since the birth of the Church of Jesus Christ about almost 2,000 years ago, on the day of Pentecost, next week we're going to be celebrating Pentecost. It's going to be a wonderful time as we all come back together and worship the Lord together. It's going to be exciting to worship on the day of Pentecost. And there's a lot of things that I want to talk about in regards to the day of Pentecost next week that I have to share with you. But since the days of the birth of the church, the mission of the church has not changed. The mission has always been expand the kingdom of God by preaching the gospel, seeing people come into the kingdom. People need salvation in Jesus Christ, so we share the gospel with people. And yet it seems that like we go through times in history where the church just loses its emphasis of reaching out and touching the lives of people who need Christ as their personal Savior. We just get satisfied, it seems like, with going to church, having our families, going through the motions, and just having a really comfortable life. Comfort is what we seek sometimes. And it happens. It seems like we go through these cycles. And when we go through those cycles where we get real comfortable, God does something to shake us up. Maybe that's what He's doing right now, shaking us up a little bit, allowing us to recognize that, hey, there are some very important things going on here. And the most important thing is that people need to know Jesus as their personal Savior. We're comfortable today with our religion. We're comfortable with our culture. We're comfortable with our society. We're comfortable with our lifestyles. But I plead with you this morning, let's get to the place where we're no longer comfortable with the status quo. Let's walk in such a way, let's seek the Lord in such a way that we are so uncomfortable with comfort that we're willing to do whatever God tells us to do. And I want to tell you, sometimes that's not the popular thing to do. There is persecution sometimes. Sometimes it's just verbal persecution. We've never really experienced here in the United States physical persecution for our faith in Jesus Christ, at least not for many, many years. We've had the freedom to be able to worship the Lord. But I can tell you this, if you step outside of the status quo or the religious order of things, the expected way things are supposed to be done, you will be persecuted verbally. If you tell people about sin and that they need to be saved. They're sinners and they need to be saved by the grace of God. You will suffer verbal persecution. If you say that you believe that you can lay hands on the sick and they shall recover, hallelujah, a wonderful testimony that our sister had this morning. God is still on the throne doing things. If you say that you believe in casting out devils, you will be verbally persecuted. I'm telling you, the radical church of Jesus Christ, when it rises up, is a persecuted church in one way or another. During the time of great persecution of Christians in Rome, there was an incident that forever changed one senator. He was against Christianity, and he called all his servants that he knew were Christians, and he sent them to the Colosseum. Now, during this time in Rome, Christians were being persecuted horribly. They were put in Colosseums, and wild animals released on them, and they were torn apart, most of the time by lions and other bears, other horrible creatures. Sometimes they would have the gladiators take their life, martyr them. Most of the time, the Christians just stood and allowed the sword to be put to their heads. This was a terrible time of persecution, and this guy hated the Christians. And he called them all together, and he sent them to the Colosseum. And he went to the Colosseum that day to watch all the Christians being dying for their faith. And as he sat in his special seat, along with his wife, as they sat there and watched the Christians walk out and line up, something incredible happened. His wife suddenly leaped up from her chair and ran down to the Colosseum where the Christians were, grabbed the hand of a servant girl, and stood there prepared to die along with all the other Christians. Her faith was worth dying for. Is our faith really worth dying for today? I think we need to search our hearts. Where are we in this Christian thing? Is it just a comfortable way of life? Or are we really sold out to Jesus Christ? Amen. Second thing I want to share with you, nothing can overpower the church of Jesus. What we need to recognize is that the church is much stronger than people realize. All we need to be is in rhythm with the Holy Spirit. And when we're in rhythm with the Holy Spirit, not even the gates of hell will prevail against us. But I can tell you this, religion stifles the church. Relationship empowers the church. And that's what I'm calling you to this morning, is relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ, with the Father through the Son. When the church is empowered, nothing can stop us, not even the gates of hell. And hell wants to stop you. I want you to know that. You have opposition. You have an enemy who wants to stop you in your tracks. You have an enemy who wants to put a stop to you standing up for your faith in Jesus Christ. You have an enemy who wants to stifle you in your family, in your relationships. You have an enemy who wants to keep you from being a voice that says, the Lord Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. In the workplace, in society, you know, it's minor right now. But if we're not careful, it could grow. I'm calling you to a place this morning, a place of repentance for all of us, a place where we recognize, hey, this is a serious matter. And the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds and the casting down of imaginations and any high thing that is exalted above Jesus Christ, anything. We have that power in our lives. We don't act like it very often, but we do. Hallelujah. I know I'm not probably not getting a lot of amens from this message. but I'm calling you to a higher calling in Jesus Christ. These signs shall follow them that believe. Where are the signs? What's happening to us today? They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. That's not just a maybe. He didn't say, you can lay hands on the sick and then possibly recover. Maybe they'll recover. They shall recover. You shall cast out devils. You shall speak with new tongues. If any drink any deadly thing, it shall not. Nothing deadly is going to come against you and stop you. This is the power of God. Where is it? What's happening? You know what? I feel like as the church, what we're more concerned about is whether we're going to be accepted by the world rather than whether we're accepted by the Lord. Is the world going to condemn us for laying hands on the sick? Is the world going to condemn us because, and let me say this, it's not just the world. The religious order of the day will also condemn you because you're stepping outside of the boundaries that they have set up to keep you, to keep the church, the body of Christ, corralled in a certain area so that you can be controlled. You can't control the body of Christ. The body of Christ is going to rise up. The body of Christ is going to move out. We are warriors in the name of Jesus Christ. The body of Christ is alive and well today. As I said earlier, the early church was harassed by the world and by religious persecution. The authorities rose up against people who believed in the fact that Jesus Christ was the only way to salvation. Anyone who would say that the church, the organized church, was not the way to salvation, that only faith in Jesus Christ was the way to salvation, was persecuted early on. Tradition holds that all the apostles were martyred, except John, for their faith in Jesus Christ. And it didn't stop there for hundreds of years. The church, the true church of Jesus Christ, was martyred. The established church was a part of that killing of real Christians. The world and the church came together. That's the reason our forefathers was opposed to church and state being married to one another. Religious freedom was a good thing, but church and state coming together is a horrible thing. Guard against that. But followers of Jesus Christ were persecuted. And for hundreds of years, the early church suffered persecution. Many of the people conformed, but there was a group of people, Bohemia and Moravia, who refused to conform to the ways of the church, only to the gospel of Jesus Christ. They had a leader by the name of John Huss. And John Huss was a Bohemian, and he preached the gospel of Jesus Christ. And because of that, in 1415, he was tied to a stake and burned alive. Many of his followers were persecuted thereafter, and it just continued for hundreds of years. He was from Bohemia, and some of these other followers were from Moravia, modern-day Czech Republic. People continued to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ under great persecution. And then in the 1700s, something happened. God provided some relief for some of these persecuted Christians. He provided a nobleman in Germany by the name of Count Zinzendorf. Zinzendorf had become a believer in Jesus Christ, and he turned his back on the limelight in Paris, and he said that he was going to serve only the Lord Jesus Christ. Here is his motto. He said, I have one passion, Jesus and Jesus only. Zinzendorf had a huge estate in Germany, in Herrnhut, Germany. And he offered refuge to these Christians. And he brought all the Christians who wanted to come. He offered refuge to them. And they came and they lived there. But after a short period of time while they were there, they began quarreling with one another. They had doctrinal disputes and they heated arguments and they threatened to have great division among them. There was discord, and the order of the day was hatred rather than love. Instead of brotherly unity of strife. Zinzendorf and the leaders didn't know what to do, but the leaders knew that they were a part of the problem. So they repented and they prayed and they began to seek the face of God. And they asked God to show up. I believe that's what we need to do. Ask God to show up among believers. Ask God to give us strength, give us boldness, give us the ability to be able to overcome the wiles of the devil, the schemes that the devil has against us. They began to pray, they repented, they prayed, they sought the face of God. And then in August the 13th, 1727, something happened as they all began to worship God. There was a great outpouring of the Holy Spirit. The Spirit descended on the Moravian Brethren, and that's what they were known as by this time. And the power of God began to move among them. God began to heal the divisions, the discord. Now listen, I want you to understand something. These were Christians. These were born-again people. And yet they had allowed their flesh to rise up inside of them. And they began to argue over non-essential issues and have discord among one another. But when that day happened, the Holy Spirit fell upon them. Things began to change immediately. Let me read to you Zinzendorf's very own account of what happened. The Savior permitted to come upon us a spirit of whom we had hitherto not had any experience or knowledge. Hitherto, we had been the leaders and the helpers. Now, the Holy Spirit himself took full control of everything and everybody. That's what I'm praying for. The Holy Spirit will take full control of everything and everybody. I'd like to see that happen this Sunday when we come back together. The Spirit poured out in such a way that he's controlling everything and everybody. And let me tell you something. If you're watching this via our stream, you won't recognize what's going on. You'll wonder what's happening. If Holy Spirit takes control, I welcome it. I desire it. This outpouring lasted for 100 years. And from that time on, things were different among the Moravians. The Moravians are known even today for their love, their compassion, their concern for one another and for the world. They have been some of the most prevalent believers in sharing and spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ than any group of believers all over the world. They printed Bibles. They sent out missionaries all over the world, and it was all to their own peril, because many of them died as martyrs because they were willing to share the gospel of Jesus. They did more to spread the gospel than any of their contemporary brethren because they had a true experience. They were believers in Jesus Christ, but something happened. The Holy Spirit began to fill each and every one of them. Just like on the day of Pentecost. When that happens, things change. We need a move of the Spirit just like that. Last thing I want to say to you this morning is the Church of Jesus Christ will be and is the true church, is a radical church. Well, some of you may not like to hear that. And I got to tell you, my personality is such that I like comfort. I like the status quo. I like to go along and get along. I don't like turmoil. But I can tell you this. As I read the New Testament, I see a church that was so radical that wherever they went, they stirred up the powers of darkness and they stirred them up against the church. The power of God was available. Things happened. People were healed. Devils were driven out. Incredible things took place. But the enemy did rise up. We've got to expect that. If we're going to be a radical church, we've got to expect, and I'm talking about the church at large, I'm talking about the church of Jesus Christ. If we're going to be radical for Jesus, we've got to expect some opposition. Don't be surprised by the opposition. Just expect it. You can wear it as a badge if you want, a badge of honor, but you know you're doing something for Jesus. Here's what happened on the day of Pentecost. When the day of Pentecost had fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Just like the story of the Moravians. They were radical for one reason, because they had unity. They were not arguing about anything and everything, and discord among them. There was peace in the church. The world takes notice when the church is at peace, no matter what's going on. The world is looking to the church today to see if we can have some peace in this time of difficulty. And I got to tell you, there's nothing like having the peace of God upon you when everybody else seems to be hysterical. Acts 2:2. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then there appeared to them divided tongues of fire, and one sat upon each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak with other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. And there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And when this sound occurred, the multitude came together and were confused, because everyone heard them speak in his own language. So they were all amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "Whatever could this mean?" Others mocking said, "They are all full of new wine." You see what I mean? Even when the Spirit of God is poured out and people began to move by the power of the Holy Spirit, there were still those who were going to mock and say, "Oh, they're just a bunch of drunks. They've been drinking. Don't pay any attention to them. They're crazy. They're just emotional. They're just letting their emotions rule them and dictate them." You say, when we start praising God, raising our hands and jumping around and dancing before the Lord, people say, "Oh, that's just a bunch of emotion." Well, it is emotion, yes, absolutely. But it's emotion that's stirred by the Holy Spirit inside of us to worship our living God and to express it in a way that He recognizes. Not that you recognize or you care about. That He recognizes. David danced before the Lord and he was criticized by his wife. Why? Because she was concerned that he was getting too much attention. Maybe you get too much attention when you worship the Lord. It's not our goal. I don't raise my hands and worship God to draw attention to myself, except that I might draw attention to myself that my God would see my true worship of Him. That's why we do the things we do. That's why we believe the things we believe. God is still offering for us to come before Him. He's looking for those who will worship Him in spirit and truth. What's that look like? Sometimes it looks like people who are sitting in the pews silently. Sometimes it looks like people who are clapping their hands and praising God. Sometimes it looks like people who are raising their hands. But sometimes it looks like a bunch of crazy people worshiping God because they love the Lord Jesus Christ. And they jump around because they know their God has set them free. If God set you free from your sins, you have a reason to worship Him and praise Him. When the Spirit Spirit-filled Church of Jesus Christ begins to operate by the power of the Spirit is never accepted by the world or the religious order. It's always condemned. Acts 2:17 tells us just how radical we're supposed to be. And it shall come to pass in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams. And on my maidservants and my men servants and my maidservants, I will pour out my Spirit in those days, and they shall prophesy. There's going to be some radical things take place in the Church of Jesus Christ in these last days. Young people are going to prophesy. Old people are going to prophesy and see dreams. People are going to get radical for Jesus Christ because He is King of Kings and Lord of Lords. It's time for us to set aside our inhibitions and begin to worship God with all our heart, soul, and mind. All I can ask you today is, do you want to be a part of a radical church for Jesus? Or you can choose to be a part of the powerless religious order of the day. It's your choice. I choose Jesus above all else. I told you about the Moravians and how God changed their hearts. Well, John Wesley was touched by the Moravians as well. He was raised in a very strict religious home, and he learned to be a very religious person. But as he grew up, he began to wrestle with faith in Jesus Christ. And he questioned his faith because of the people that called themselves Christians and the way that they acted and the things that they did. And he was searching. While he was searching, he took a trip from England to the American colonies. And while he was on this ship, he encountered a group of people that he called the Germans. They were Moravians. And the people, many of the people that was on board this ship, the English, called themselves Christians. But as he observed the Christian English and the German Moravian Christians, he recognized something that was so different from them. The Moravians served one another with brotherly love. The Moravians served the other passengers and crew. Didn't take any payment for it. They just wanted to be servants. They said, it makes us humble before the Lord. The Moravians, although the English would argue all the time about all kinds of things, the Moravians never argue about anything. The Moravians allowed Christ to lead and guide their life. And one day there was a great storm that came upon the ship. The wind and the waves were huge. The one wave broke over the bow of the ship and broke the mast. It washed down into the inner workings, the inner parts of the church or of the ship. And the Moravians at that time were having church, and they were singing hymns to God. And what John Wesley observed was that the English cried out with great cries in fear, and they were greatly afraid that they were going to die, and rightfully so. It looked like as a possibility. But the Moravians just continued worshiping God and praising Him. It was as if nothing was even happening. They had their full and total trust in the Lord. John Wesley went on to the Americas, and then he went back to England. When he went back to England, he was wrestling greatly with his faith and trying to figure out what it meant to really serve God. When he was invited to a Moravian service, and he went to one of their services, and they were preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, that Jesus was the Son of God, that Jesus was the Savior, and all you had to do was put your faith in Him. It had nothing to do with works, has nothing to do with who you are other than the fact that you received Jesus as your personal Savior. That day, John Wesley received Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. The rest is pretty much the history that we know. John Wesley became a great proponent of the gospel of Jesus. He was a part of the Great Awakening, the first Great Awakening in the colonies. He established the Methodist Church, and he established a great organization that was not built on church hierarchy, but built on the love and the blood of Jesus Christ. I'm not just preaching about the Methodist Church today. God has done many things in many church organizations in the past where people have come to the realization that Jesus truly is the Lord and God, and you have to put aside religion. Many Methodists need to put aside religion today. Many Episcopals need to put aside religion today. Many Charismatics need to put aside religion today and embrace the fullness of the Spirit of God as he washes over us and leads us into a new, awesome way of living. God moves among his people as he desires. And there's a lot of different things that happen when God moves. Different ways he manifests himself, and I'm not looking for any specific way. I'm just open to whatever God wants to do from this time forward. Whatever. Praise God. If you're hearing this message this morning, and those of you who are out there, I'm just going to ask you to stand with me. Thank you. I just want to say to you, today is a new day in Jesus Christ. It's a day to make a wholehearted commitment to serving him. A day to know that Jesus Christ is Lord of your life. Maybe you've been, like John Wesley, a religious person. God wants to bring you totally and completely into his kingdom. He wants you to know Jesus is your personal Savior. And maybe you're just out there and you've allowed the cares of this world and life in itself, or maybe even the pursuit of material things to get in the way of your relationship with the Lord. And you want to renew that today. We're just going to do that right now. Hallelujah. Bow your head and pray with me. Father God, I praise you. And I thank you for your people out there. If there's anyone out there who is for the first time making a commitment to Jesus Christ, Father, help them to know that you are the way, you are the truth, and you are the life, Jesus. Today, they commit their life to you. And just pray this prayer with me. Today, Father God, I recognize that I'm a sinner and I need to be saved by your grace. I receive Christ as my personal Savior. I believe that you sent him to this earth as our Lord, that he died on the cross, and on the third day he came back to life. I believe that, and I receive him right now in Jesus' name. And if you have just kind of strayed from the faith and you need that fire to be kindled in you again, Father God, speak to their hearts today. In Jesus' name, I receive your fullness, Father God. Today in my life, stir my heart. I recommit my life wholly, wholly and completely to you. And I trust that you are my God and you will lead and direct me in all things. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. If you prayed either one of those prayers out there in our streaming world, please contact me and let me know. God bless and have an awesome day.